ARDS, Acute Respiratory Distress Syndrome. You need four things for it to be ARDS or ARDS. One, it needs to be acute, meaning something happens, then all of a sudden you have ARDS within hours to days. Number two, you need to have bilateral pulmonary infiltrates on chest imaging, whether that's a chest x-ray or a CAT scan of the lungs. And then three, because you have these pulmonary infiltrates, you have low oxygenation. Specifically, in order to meet the criteria, you need a PO2 to FiO2 ratio of less than 300. It used to be 200, but now it's 300. And then the fourth thing that you need for it to be ARDS is some kind of evidence to say that this is not due to the left side of the heart. In other words, this is non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema going on. So let's dive a little deeper into each one of those and talk a little bit more about ARDS. Let's dive a little deeper into ARDS. We mentioned the low oxygenation. In order to calculate this, you'll need an ABG to measure the PO2 in the arterial blood. Normally, a healthy person is going to have a PO2 of 100 or so. Then you take the FiO2, which is the percentage of oxygen the patient is breathing. Room air is 21%, so that would be 0.21. If you have them on 100% oxygen, that would be 1.00. So for me and you right now, our PO2 to FiO2 ratio would be 100 divided by 0.20, which comes out to about 500. So of course, you and I are nowhere near meeting the ARDS threshold of less than 300. Used to be 200, but now it's 300. The third requirement to meet ARDS criteria is having bilateral pulmonary infiltrates on chest imaging. So check out this chest x-ray from a patient of mine. On this chest x-ray, you see that the endotracheal tube tip is right around here. Ideally, you want that to be 2 to 4 centimeters above the carina. The carina is right here, and this tip appears to be about 4 centimeters above that. So this is a good enough position here. This is the central line here and the right internal jugular. Looking at the diaphragm and the costophrenic angles, don't see any fluid there or here, so no pleural effusions. The heart looks normal in size. I wouldn't say there's any cardiomegaly. And then the obvious here is the pulmonary infiltrates. So pretty extensive on this side, pretty extensive on this side. This is a heterogeneous pattern. If it was homogeneous, the entire lung parenchyma would be white. But there are areas of black here, so this is definitely a heterogeneous pattern. Sometimes in ARDS, it can progress to a homogeneous pattern, but this is classic ARDS looking, but doesn't tell the whole story. If I showed this chest x-ray to you without any clinical context, you'd say this could be pulmonary edema due to left-sided heart failure. And I'd say, yeah, it could be just about anything. So there needs to be some kind of evidence to suggest that these pulmonary infiltrates are non-cardiogenic in nature. So it's best to get an echo to see if there's anything wrong with the left side of the heart. If that's the case, it's easy to say that this is non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. The waters get muddied when someone has left-sided heart dysfunction, because it's not like CHF patients are excluded from getting ARDS. But for board purposes, I wouldn't expect them to give you a muddied case like that. In the old days, you need to do a pulmonary arterial catheterization, meaning a Swan-Ganz catheter, in order to determine the pulmonary capillary wedge pressure. If the wedge pressure is less than 18 millimeters mercury, it means the pulmonary edema is non-cardiogenic. But today, if there's not any evidence of left-sided heart failure on echo, we can say that this is non-cardiogenic pulmonary edema. It's good enough. There is one diagnosis out there that is actually impossible to differentiate from ARDS unless you do a specific test. The disease is called acute eosinophilic pneumonia, and the only way to differentiate it from ARDS is by doing a bronchoscopy that demonstrates more than 25% eosinophils in the BAL, the bronchoalveolar lavage. All right, so back to this chest x-ray. This x-ray by itself just tells you that there are extensive bilateral infiltrates. So you need to know the clinical context based on the patient's history and other clinical clues. If a patient with this x-ray is a young person who vaporized and had acute inhalational injury, you're thinking ARDS. Or if it's a young person who aspirated, or if they sustained a trauma or a septic shock, you're thinking ARDS. On the other hand, if it's an older person with a cardiac history and they have a high BNP level or a low ejection fraction, you know it's going to be cardiogenic pulmonary edema. The most common causes of ARDS are aspiration, pneumonia, severe sepsis, inhalation injuries. Other causes include near drowning, severe trauma, severe pancreatitis, transfusion of blood products, and fat embolism. Why do they cause ARDS? I don't know. We just know that somehow it causes this crazy, chaotic, inflammatory response within the lungs. During this chaos, there's damage to the alveoli and surrounding capillaries, which leads to excess protein and fluid accumulation in the interstitial and alveolar spaces. That means decreased lung compliance, increased VQ mismatch, and increases in shunt and dead space ventilation. And not that you would ever biopsy someone with ARDS because they're too sick for that, but if you did, the histology would show diffuse alveolar damage. Patients with ARDS are at high risk of mortality, which increases with ARDS severity. With that said, mortality is usually the result of the underlying disease itself that triggered the ARDS, rather than refractory hypoxemia. The severity of ARDS is important because it's going to determine how we manage patients. And severity is determined by the PO2 to FiO2 ratio. To be more specific, it's the ratio that you calculate while they are mechanically ventilated with a PEEP of at least 5. But let's not get caught up in the minutia, because let's say you get the ABG before they're intubated. It's not like you're going to say, well, I can't calculate the severity of ARDS because they're not intubated with a PEEP of 5. So now that we got that out of the way, the severity of ARDS goes like this. Mild is if the PO2 to FiO2 ratio is between 200 to 300. Moderate is if that ratio is 100 to 200. And then severe is if that ratio ends up being less than 100. So besides treating the underlying disease of ARDS, you need to know the things that improve it, especially what improves mortality. Methylprednisolone, AKA Solumedrol, if given early, for severe ARDS, may improve ICU length of stay and number of days on mechanical ventilation. If it does work, it's because you're suppressing the inflammation that occurs in the beginning phase of ARDS. So this is the first few days of ARDS. Later on, you get the proliferative phase and then the fibrotic stage. So like we talked about earlier, the alveoli fill up with protein and fluid. This leads to at least partial alveolar collapse and decreased lung compliance with shunt physiology. So what are we to do? The answer is to increase the PEEP, the positive end expiratory pressure. Put simply, PEEP is the positive pressure left in the chest at the end of expiration. When the patient exhales their breath, air moves out of the lungs and into the endotracheal tube. Air moves this way because of differences in pressure. It goes from high pressure to low pressure. So if they're exhaling and there's a valve that keeps some of that air inside, there's going to be a certain positive pressure. You simply dial that PEEP on the ventilator to whatever you want. Increasing the PEEP minimizes repeated opening and closing of the distal airways and alveoli. It also improves homogeneity of the lung parenchyma by reducing drastic differences in regional lung compliance. Third, it improves VQ mismatch and shunt physiology by maintaining alveolar recruitment. You're essentially popping open those alveoli. What is the ideal level of PEEP? No one knows for sure. Normally, when a patient without ARDS is intubated, we set the PEEP to 5. But if they have ARDS, we want it to be around 10 or 15. If it's really severe, sometimes we'll go all the way to 20. You don't want it to be too high though, because this increases the risk of pneumothorax. So here's a table from the ARDSnet trial that gives a suggested PEEP and FiO2 strategy. Just remember that a good rule of thumb is the more severe the ARDS, the higher PEEP you're gonna wanna use. So increasing the PEEP pops open alveoli and improves oxygenation. And that's great. If you're taking the boards and they ask you, how would you improve the oxygenation? And you have to choose between increasing the PEEP or increasing the FiO2, always, always increase the PEEP. But what is the only thing that has been shown to improve mortality in ARDS? Yep, that's right. Using low tidal volumes. So having low tidal volume ventilation and increasing the PEEP are the keys to managing patients with ARDS. So we said in ARDS, there are areas of good lung adjacent to areas of bad lung. The areas of bad lung with decreased compliance makes them more vulnerable to volume trauma and barotrauma. So this is the reason why the ARDSnet trial showed a significant reduction in mortality with the use of low tidal volumes. Current ARDS goals include both a tidal volume of 6 mL per kg of predicted body weight and maintenance of the lowest possible plateau pressure. Typically, this comes out to tidal volumes in the 300 range for women of average height and tidal volumes of 400 range for men of average height. But you might imagine that giving a patient low lung volumes might not be too comfortable for them. So it's important to properly sedate patients in order to accomplish our lung protective strategy of low lung volume ventilation. And it's okay if they develop a little respiratory acidosis. It's called permissive hypercapnia. That's the sacrifice we make in order to achieve our ultimate goal, which is survival. Now let's talk about some other things that you can do for patients with ARDS. Recently, the PROCEVA trial demonstrated improved mortality in ARDS patients with a PO2 to FiO2 ratio of less than 150 who were treated with early prone positioning and low lung tidal volume ventilation. So why is prone positioning beneficial? When we lay in a prone position, the weight of the heart is no longer compressing the posterior lung regions, and this allows for improved VQ matching. Also, with positive pressure ventilation, the diaphragm moves more freely in the prone position, which means better chest wall compliance and better gas exchange in the lower lung fields. To get the maximum benefit, proning should be done for 16 hours a day. So give some appreciation to your nurses. In patients with severe refractory hypoxemia, both prone positioning and ECMO can be considered, but the evidence for using ECMO is less convincing. Other methods to optimize ventilator management in ARDS have been suggested, including using inverse ratio ventilation and high frequency oscillatory ventilation, but none of these have been demonstrated to improve mortality in ARDS patients, at least in adults. And finally, what about paralytics? Neuromuscular blockade like sesagocurium is sometimes used for severe, refractory, or life-threatening hypoxemia, especially if there's severe vent dyssynchrony. In ARDS, paralytics may help to achieve lung protective ventilation by eliminating spontaneous breaths and ventilator dyssynchrony. Neuromuscular blockade, like with sesagocurium, aka Nimbex, is sometimes used for severe, refractory, or life-threatening hypoxemia, especially if there's severe vent dyssynchrony. In ARDS, paralytics may help to achieve lung protective ventilation by eliminating the spontaneous breaths and vent dyssynchrony. There's not enough evidence to definitively say that there's a mortality benefit of using paralytics. And the downside to using them is that there's the potential for critical illness myopathy and neuropathy. So only use neuromuscular blockade if you absolutely have to. So that's all I got for ARDS. Thanks for watching. I like watching these videos. And if you want to see some more of these videos and learn some medicine, make sure you subscribe. Give this video a thumbs up if you liked it. Give it a thumbs down if you didn't like it. And I'll see you in the next one.